morning, church.
Good morning.
Psalm 84, verse 10. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. My name is Michael Davis, and I'll be your worship leader for today. We may have rain outside, we may be in a pandemic, but I wanted to bring some news just in case you needed a reminder that Jesus is still Lord. Nothing will change that. It doesn't matter what your circumstances look like, what's going on, Jesus shall reign. So please join me in preparing your hearts and minds as we begin praise and worship.
Amen.
You came from heaven.
Please stand for the call to worship, which can be found on the back of your bulletin. You will be the people, I will be the leader. Let us gather to worship.
Oh God, we wish to see Jesus.
We come to worship, to pray, and lift up the name of Jesus.
We come looking for Jesus in scripture lessons, in our own life experiences, and in serving and praying for each other.
We seek to follow in the way of Jesus. We lay bare before God and one another.
We each have experienced our own wilderness journey filled with reluctance and sorrow, pain and with fear and confusion. But knowing that God is always with us, He promised to never leave us or forsake us.
Oh God, speak to us, show us, touch us with your presence. Together, let our faith journey lead us to Jesus, so that we may show forth Jesus in our lives. This, our household of faith, our community, and our world. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus, Lord, and we just want to thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that you are just so awesome, God, and you are so worthy of all the praise, and we just want to give that to you today, Father God. Thank you for everybody who was able to make it to here today, Father God, and we also are thankful and pray for the people that are watching online, and please touch all our hearts and minds and help us to always be centered and think of you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. We will now have announcements and church news by Sister Charlotte Nelson. That should be followed by remarks by the chairman of the Deacon Board, Deacon Kenneth L. Mickens, and then pastoral remarks in that order.
Amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
What a blessed day it is to come out and just worship God in spirit and in truth.
Amen. Yeah.
Our announcements for today. We first have a card. Blessed are the givers, and grateful are the receivers. Thank you so much. Thank you, Solid Rock, for your prayers and cards and the passing of my stepfather, Mr. Thomas Banks. Your brother in Christ, Brother Ricky Banks.
Amen.
Amen. Your announcements for today. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, as also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work.
Amen.
Nehemiah 2:18.
Amen.
Solid Rock has established the endowment program so that we might glorify God by building our new church.
Amen.
Locust Lane, which is going on right now as I speak.
Amen.
The endowment program allows participants to purchase a permanent reminder of their devotion to God and to Solid Rock. You may also support this effort by simply contributing to the Solid Rock Building Fund. Contributions to the building fund can also be made by visiting the Solid Rock website and clicking on the donation button. In addition, please empty the weight from your pockets and purses by bringing your coins and depositing it into our Change for Church container and watch the temperature rise on our thermometer. Solid Rock 2021, all in, looking back and leaping forward.
Amen.
Amen.
COVID vaccine, we are progressing further along in phase one for individuals to receive the COVID vaccine. By April 19, 2021, all individuals 16 and older in Pennsylvania will be eligible to be vaccinated. Please pay attention to this information and get your vaccinations.
Amen.
The goal is to return to pre-pandemic mode. To do this, we must achieve herd immunity, meaning that at least 80 to 90% of the population must be vaccinated. It is important that we all get vaccinated. So when it is your turn, please get your vaccine. and you are fully vaccinated 2 weeks after the second dose of Pfizer or Moderna vaccines and 2 weeks after the one dose of Johnson & Johnson, you must still follow COVID protocol. That means masks, social distancing, and good hand washing.
Amen.
Pastor Keyes has requested that all ministry leaders complete a mission and vision statement, as well as responsibilities, expectations for your ministry. This is due by April 23rd, 2021. Please email your document to the church secretary at blmickens@verizon.net. A copy will be placed in the office file. So if you have not completed your vision and mission statement, please adhere to the date, April 23rd, 2021. Please keep in prayer about Brother Willie Harris, Spring Creek Nursing and Rehabilitation Center, room 313, Brother Paul Carey, UPMC Pentecost Community General, Sister Arvella Riddick, the Jewish Home and Rehabilitation Center, and Trustee Christopher Harris, who's at home. Mm-hmm. To notify the church of any illness, hospitalization, or death in your family, please email the Assistant Church Secretary, Sister Jamie Foster, at jamiecfoster@gmail.com. God bless you and have a blessed day.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Praise this holy name. I'm glad to be here this morning. Glad to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
You know, there's something about being in the presence of the saints at the assigned time, no matter what. You know, we have things that we're dealing with, but we have obstacles that we have to cross and abide by, but God is still on the throne.
Amen.
Make no mistake about that. And he's going to provide for and protect his people.
Amen.
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 I'm coming forward for two things today. First, Solid Rock members, you know this, but you need to be reminded from time to time. Our primary mode of communication, the primary mode of communication for the Solid Rock Missionary Baptist Church is through email.
Amen.
So when you see an email come through on that subject line from Solid Rock, my advice to you is to read it, not to ignore it. Why? Because most of the time, 99% of the time, it's important information. We don't just send things out just to be busy. When we send an email, it's typically important information that you should pay attention to. And before you proceed to church on Sunday morning, check your email.
Amen.
Let me say that again. Before you proceed to in-person church on Sunday morning, always check your email.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
That's important. Secondly, the primary in Pennsylvania is May 18th. Primary in Pennsylvania is May 18th. Now, this is a significant election for a number of reasons, but one of the things that's sort of been lost in the process is that there is a constitutional amendment that's on the ballot for the primary. And this constitutional amendment would allow the legislature to limit the ability of the governor to declare an emergency situation and proceed with certain restrictions similar to what occurred with the pandemic.
Amen.
All right? Now this is a constitutional amendment that is on the ballot for the primary on May 18th, asking you whether you want to let the legislature make those kinds of decisions or the governor. That's basically what it boils down to. So this is an important question. Okay? Unfortunately, the COVID-19 pandemic that we're going through now probably won't be the last pandemic that we have to deal with. So we need to be concerned about who's going to be making those decisions and under what circumstances. Amen?
Amen.
Also, in regard to the election, the Dauphin County Election Office has moved. As you know, it used to be on South 2nd Street in the Dauphin County building. Now it is located at 1251 South 28th Street. That's in Swatara Township. Okay, 1251 South 28th Street. That's in Swatara Township. The last day to request an absentee ballot is May 11th. And by the way, in Pennsylvania, you know you requested an absentee ballot for the general election back in November 2020. For the primary, you have to request it again. Okay, for each election, you have to request it. So contact www.votespa.com. And if you go to that website, it will tell you all the information you need to do, you need to be aware of in order to request an absentee ballot. It also will tell you about how you can vote early in Pennsylvania, which is very important. That information is there. Amen?
Amen.
As you know, we're going to continue to keep our members aware of current events and things that they should be aware of.
Amen.
That's what we do here at Solid Rock. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Thank you so much.
We will now have the hymn of praise, Lift Him Up. Please stand.
Oh,
video by our own Reverend Thomas A. Keys, and that will be followed by the reading of the Holy Scripture by Deaconess Dara Bostic, and intercessory prayer by our speaker, Reverend Derwin Johnson.
Praise the Lord, everybody. All right, we thank God today. I'm going to be loud. Give God praise. Come on, give glory to God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Jesus is worthy of every praise. Every praise is to our God. Everyone will worship. Hallelujah. To his name. Hallelujah. Thank God. Love to be a part of our service this morning. We want to give God our Father all the honor. Jesus said all the praise. We're going to bless the presence of the Holy Spirit in your house and in this house today. Amen. Thank God for it all. Thank God for being a part. I mean, Pastor Thomas Keith and Son, we're going to have a church. Thank God for joining us on worship service today. Brother, we are continuing on in this wonderful year in 2020. We are all in, y'all. Looking back, looking forward. And we have taken some tremendous leaps forward in 2021. Amen. This mission that God has us on building this church, not just the people, but the building as well. We've come a long way, and we are getting close to the finish line. So, beloved, we would ask for prayers, we would solicit your support, and we would also ask you to continue to give as you're able and watch what God will do. We're all there, looking back and looking forward to the great things God has in store. As many of you know, Pastor Keys is dealing with a little health issue today. Mr. Gibson and I are having to rest for quarantine for a minute, so we'll be out of the pulpit. We won't be back on the first Sunday in May. We are so grateful for your prayers, for your support, for your calls. We are resting and doing well, and I think doing better every day. So thank y'all for everything that you're doing and continue to support us and continue to support my wife as we continue to do the great things that God has in store. COVID-19 update, there are vaccines going out. Many people being vaccinated. We're into the 1B and going into the 1C stage here in Pennsylvania. So while vaccines are going out at a rapid pace, cases seem to be going up. We've even had some cases that affected our family here at Top Rock. Well, right now we're monitoring everything. We're continuing our social distancing, our mask wearing, our sanitation of our being in place for worship, and we're providing our services online. So as things change, we will change our procedures. But beloved, we are staying diligent to watch your email, watch the Facebook page and the website, and we will continue to keep you posted. So please, man, please church, continue to pray for us, and watch what God will do for us in our lives. Tomorrow morning, 6 o'clock a.m., we will be meeting on our prayer conference call. The numbers on the screen and on the back of the bulletin and on the website. So please, man, please, sir, join us tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock. We really need to seek God's face. We need to pray. We need to ask his blessing and his protection. And God will do it. And he'll continue to do it when we ask him. So this is the time, though, that we need to pray and ask for God's grace and strength in these difficult times. So let's come on Tuesday. Beloved, let your young people, your youth know that there is a Zoom Sunday school every Tuesday at 9 at 6 p.m. led by Deacon Andrew Ellis, Deacon Lou Webster, and teacher in training, Brother Isaiah Boston.
Amen.
We have a great curriculum and great teachers who are willing and able to share the good news of the Lord with people that are very young. So join us for that. You will be glad you did. And then we have our Sunday school. Youth and adults. Adults and older adults, and we meet every Saturday at 11 o'clock, amen. Sunday school on Saturday, y'all, at the breakfast hour, amen. Each month come calling, get your answers, and listen to great teachers, great curriculum. You can ask questions. You can interact with other believers. It is really a great time to Zoom every Saturday at 11 o'clock a.m. Amen.
Amen.
Bible study, beloved, we're going to take a little bit of a break, a little pause. We're going to reconvene in Bible study on May the 5th. Amen. At 6:30 p.m. So take a little break between now and then, and we will continue on with our great Bible study sessions coming up on next month, Wednesday, May the 5th at 6:30. We're going to have an exciting time in the Lord. Hopefully, one thing here will be together. We might even meet together, so we'll see. So Bible study, join us for a great time in the Lord. Amen. Amen. We're so happy to have Reverend Donald Johnson. We've had him before. We've been blessed by his ministry. And I'm sure that he has a word for us. But he's going to need your amen, y'all. We need to pour our brother, pray for him. So let's pray God for him. Amen. And we want to appreciate the honor. Thank you for being here. He has word for us. I'm looking forward to it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And finally, I want to celebrate our birthdays for April. Amen. We have Chanel Brown, a wife of Minister Darrell Brown. They're currently in Atlanta, and I'm just going to celebrate her birthday on April the 8th. Cynthia Cannon is her birthday on April the 9th. Amen. Angela Ellis. Amen. Deacon Angela Ellis has a birthday coming up on Tax Day. Hallelujah, how about that? Isaiah Boston. And we have Lydia Walker and April from 6. Amen.
Amen.
Delta Robinson, I miss you, Delta, man. On April 27. And Carol Cassidy, man, God bless you. April 27. And then some woman named Kirsten Cheese, but I don't like her. Man. My beautiful wife, her birthday is 4/28. Amen. And Tay-Tay Brown, her birthday is 4/29. Amen. So let's wish them a happy birthday. You ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, everybody. Happy birthday to you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 You know, it's such a great a privilege and honor to be a pastor and be a part of this wonderful church. Let's continue to do the great things God has us doing. Let's continue to be a solid rock, Mr. Baptist Church. Welcome on, Christ be!
Solid on the rock!
God bless you, God bless you, God bless you.
Comes out of the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 1 through 7, and I'll be reading it from the New King James Version. And it reads as such. Now, after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." The word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Amen. Amen. this time we will look to the Lord in prayer. Amen. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we come as your children and say thank you for another worship experience. Lord, we thank you most of all for your wonderful Son, Jesus. Lord, the one who is our Savior, the one whom we declare, the one who made everything out of nothing. Lord, we thank you for Jesus, who is the Yeshua, the Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. We just thank you for another day. We thank you for the services that continue on in spite of the absence of Pastor Keys. We pray that you would be with him, put your healing hands upon him and his family. And we pray that you would restore his body, his health, that he would return, oh God, with vigor and with vitality to continue to do your will and your work. Yes. We just thank you now for what you're doing here at Solid Rock. We pray, oh God, that you would continue to bless Solid Rock and even bless those who you have laid in our hearts to give. Lord, we pray that this ministry would have a reverberating effect upon the communities in which it touches. Lord, we thank you, oh God, for the listening ears every Sunday, those who tune in to the worship. We pray that they're edified, that they are built up in the most holy faith. And then, oh God, we always pray that if there be one that does not know you in the pardon of their sins, oh, that today that they will find that you are a wonderful Savior, and that beside you there is none other. We just thank you now. We just bless your name for those who are here. And then we pray for those who are not here. Lord, we know that you are God that knows the needs of your people. And we know that you're the answer to all of our questions. And you're the solution to each and every problem. We thank you now and we bless you. We also want to pray for those who are sick through this COVID-19 virus. We pray for their healing. We pray for your touch. We pray for grieving families, oh God. For those who have gone on, Lord, we still need you and we still can't make it without you. And Lord, though we're in this pandemic, we know that you are able and we know that you will bring us out. We just thank you and we praise you in advance. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Father, we just thank you, Lord, for the ability to receive blessing from you, Father God, and as a privilege to give them back to you, Father God. So I just pray that you would use these tithes and offerings to help build your kingdom and help promote your word, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Here at Solid Rock, we have three ways of giving. The first is you can do by mail, by mailing to P.O. Box 4513, 5121 Derry Street, Harrisburg, PA 17111. You can give via PayPal by going on the website and clicking on the donation button, or you can give via Cash App, and that is the $TheRockPay. Again, the $TheRockPay. For those of you who are here in person, you can follow the directions of the ushers.
Amen.
Thank you.
the Lord.
Amen.
It is good to be here at Solid Rock once again. The church where the love of Christ is.
Solid Rock.
Amen. Amen. We thank God for the presence of the Lord through song and through the time of worship. Pray that the same will be true as the word goes forth. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Don't want to hold you long. Our prayers are for Pastor Keys and his speedy recovery and return. Amen. We know that God is able.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It's always good to be with you. Don't want to hold you long. Don't want to bore you. Amen. But we do have a word from the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And from, as stated, the scripture, a chapter is Matthew chapter 28. I'll just read two verses for the sake of time. Amen. Matthew chapter 28 and verse 6 and 7. Amen. And it reads, He is not here, for He is risen, as He said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell His disciples that He is risen from the dead. And behold, He goeth before you into Galilee. And as you have heard, the subject is He went in, but thank God He came out. Amen. Give the Lord some praise for that. Amen. Amen. He went in, but thank God He came out. It was interesting to me as a student at Mississippi College when I studied Western civilization. We studied a military leader from France by the name of Napoleon Bonaparte. And Napoleon, it was interesting how France looked at their wars. They believed that it didn't matter how many casualties there were, it didn't matter if others would calculate it based on other wars, if he was successful or if they won the war. But the way they looked at it is if he went into the war and he came home, he was victorious.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
If he went in, and he came back. Didn't matter how many casualties, didn't matter how many men or soldiers they lost, they looked at his war as being victorious because he returned. And my brothers and sisters, when you look at the line of blood loss for the faith, the fact that all the witnesses were primarily and for the most part were put to death for the faith. Amen. Those who have read the Fox Book of Martyrs know that how Peter died, how all the disciples, Thomas died, all of them were put to death. They were persecuted severely, all because of this message of one who died and came back. When you look at Matthew chapter 28, it begins with a problem. It begins with a troubling of the heart because they're wondering as women how they would be able to anoint the lifeless and limp body of the Lord Jesus Christ. they went mourning at the beginning, but as we're going to see, as I study, there was a writer, there was a preacher by the name of George Buttrick, and he always said, and it helped me, that you look at the movement of the text. Amen. There's some movement here because it's going to begin with the problem. Amen. It's going to begin with crying, but it's going to end with a celebration.
Amen.
It's going to begin with mourning, but it's going to end with worship. Amen. And that's the movement of the text, because the problem that they were worried about would be solved once they reached the tomb. And how many times it is that we have problems that we worry about only to find out when we reach the place of the problem has been already solved. Amen. And it's interesting because they are wondering how in the world are they going to be able to move the stone. Amen. And you know, it always, when I look at the scripture, I do this. It's just a thing that I do as a preacher, and I have a strange habit of doing this. I always look at scenarios that could have been, but the scripture doesn't say it. And actually, to me, by doing that, it becomes a little bit more richer, and it actually becomes more openly seen, and it helps us to understand we can praise God on what could have been done, even though it was not done. Amen. You'll catch up with that. Amen. You'll catch up with that. But the Lord could have come out of the grave and then stood there having moved the stone and allowed everybody to see what he did. And it would have been no questions. It wouldn't have been any issues. But he chose not to do it that way. And I looked at that and I said, but now the Matthew in his writing lets us know how the stone was moved. Yeah. Amen. You do know how the stone was moved because we read it. Amen. Yeah. Sister read it. We read it. It said that there was an angel. Mm-hmm. Amen. And the angel came from heaven. And the angel that came from heaven is the one that is given credit in Matthew's account for moving the stone. Amen. There it is in verse 2. I'm not making it up. It said the angel moved it. Now, we know in the other account there's two angels. All right? But Matthew focuses on the one that moved the stone, number one, and number two, that did the speaking. Amen. And that's very important, because I want to argue the point that my first argument is that the first preacher was not the women, was definitely not the men, but it was the angel. Amen. The angel is the one that gives the first gospel. Now that's important, because if you are a Bible reader and you have read from Genesis to Revelation, do you know who the last preacher is going to be? I'm glad you asked that question. See, this is a good group, I'm telling you. See, the last preacher is going to be just like the first one. He's not going to put that on man to be the last preacher, you know, because preachers have messed up and have done things and have not been focused and haven't, you know what I mean? But he gives it to one who hasn't fallen. Yes. I can put it that way.
Amen.
The angel didn't mess it up. The angel gave the actual fact and truth,
And then he puts an exclamation point on it and said, just like Jesus said. Amen. Isn't that a good preacher? Amen. The angel, amen, he didn't fill a bus. He didn't go into a whole lot of this and that. He sticks to the message, and this is the message of hope that we all ought to preach every time we stand up to preach.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. Somehow, some way, I heard Dr. Gardner C. Taylor said, somehow, some way, we need to make our way to Calvary. Amen. I don't care if we're preaching from the Old Testament, New Testament, wherever we come from, somewhere we need to get to the point of the gospel message, because that's where the power is.
Yeah.
Amen. That's what Paul said. Paul said the power is in the gospel. Amen. It's not just giving words, not just giving reports. It's not just this or that. No. Listen, the power is where the gospel is preached. And that's when people are helped. That's when people are saved. That's when people are edified. Is when we stand and preach and proclaim the gospel. And if we don't have a gospel to preach, then we need to sit down. Amen. We need to sit down because we don't have anything to say. Amen. And that's how important the message was that morning, because when they went there, the problem was, who's going to move the stone? The stone was moved by the angel. And I asked the question in my own mind as I was studying, once again, the Lord could have came and moved the stone and could have stood there and said, here I am on resurrection ground. I told you I have all power. I told you I was coming back. He could have did that. And then I started asking, then the Spirit of God is like he spoke to me saying, well, see, the angel dealt with the stone, but Jesus dealt with salvation. Amen. Amen. Somebody get that. Amen. Amen. The angel dealt with the rock. But Jesus deals with relationships that need to be restored to God. And we move from the problem that they thought would not be solved. And yet, had they believed the next point, from the problem to the promise. Amen. Because the text says, it says, as the angel said, he rose like he said.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. Amen. Everybody got that?
Yeah.
See, it's one thing to die, and then you haven't said anything about what you were going to do after you died, and then if you did say it, you have power to carry it out.
All right.
To bring it to fruition. Amen? Mm-hmm. Now, I say that because you all have heard of Harry Houdini. Amen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
One of the greatest escape artists of all time.
Yes, sir.
I mean, he picked locks. They put him underwater. They did everything. Put him in jail cells. He could get out of anything. But all one day, he died. And do you know that his wife, his widow, was so mesmerized at how he was able to get out of stuff. Do you know that for 10 years she lit a candle believing that he was going to come back? Because of what he said. He said, listen, he said, if there's any way to get out of it, I'm coming back. You can expect that. And he got out of so many things that he had even his wife believing that he was coming back. Died on October 31st on Halloween. And every year she would light a candle and believe that he was going to come back. But you all know what happened. He never came back. And the reason why it's important to tell this story, and others have said that they were going to die and come back. I can tell you some things. I'm not going to get into that because I'll get off of where I'm going. But there's some folk that have died and said they was coming back, but they didn't come back. And they didn't come back because they didn't have the power to do what they said. My brothers and sisters, the angel's message was, he said he was coming back, and he did.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. I want us to look at John chapter 2, verse 19. I have to turn to this because one day when I was witnessing, amen, to a lost person, as lost as could be, amen. In fact, I'll go ahead and say they were a Jehovah's Witness.
All right.
And back then, when I was witnessing to this particular person, I had went to the Christian bookstore, bought me this little Christian pamphlet that said, How to Witness to Jehovah's Witness. Well, I didn't know nothing about all that they believe. And I said, kept reading, outlining and everything until I felt comfortable. I'm going to share this and I'm going to try it out on them. And so I turn to John chapter 2, verses 19 through 21, and have them to look at and read. I said, I have a question about this verse. You all do read the Bible. You do believe in it, right? And they say, yes, I believe it. I said, let me ask you a question before I ask you a question. I said, do you believe that God wants us to be Bible literate? Or do you believe that God wants us to be literature literate? And they paused and they was thinking and wheels was turning. And they said, I believe that God wants to be Bible literate. Of course, the one that said it was the one that was in training. You see, they always have two people. The one is advanced, that knows and rooted and grounded in it. You know, they didn't say nothing. But it was a trap because the one that was in training didn't know enough not to say anything. Because once you say that, you're out on a limb that's going to break on you. Amen. And I said, okay, good. I said, good for you. I said, praise God. I said, you believe that God wants to be Bible literate because if your literature is wrong on any point, wouldn't you take God's word over the literature? And they said, oh yeah, sure, we don't, but our literature is not wrong. I said, okay, fine, that's fine. I said, can you explain this verse to me where it says, Jesus said in 2:19, they read it, Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up. Then said the Jews, 40 and 60 years was a temple in building, and will thou rear it up in 3 days? They thought he was talking about the temple that Herod built. He wasn't talking about that. It says, verse 21, but he spake of the temple of his. I said, what did that say there? They said, body. I said, temple of his what? Body, that's what it says in mine. I have the King James Version, you have it in yours, you got New World Translation. So we both agree it says body. And they said yes. I said, now, your literature says that Jesus, when he died, his body dissolved in gases. When he came back, it was not the same body, and that's why his disciples at the time didn't recognize him. I said, but now if you believe that and if your literature teaches that, you know that what you just done, you just contradict what Jesus said. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he said, uh-oh. And I said, wait a minute, well, maybe. And the other one said, no, he's not talking about his body. I said, well, this says body. It says right there. You agree? I said, let's just read verse 22 and get some interpretation because we don't need a commentary. We don't need literature. Let's let the Bible interpret itself. And we read verse 22. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered what? That he said this unto them, and they believed the scriptures and the word which Jesus said. Now, I said, let me just paint the picture a little bit stronger so you can understand why it's important to believe what he said. Mm-hmm. I said, imagine me coming back here, putting on some pantyhose, some heels, makeup, eyelashes, put on a wig. And I say to you, I'm a woman.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And I said to them, I said, am I telling the truth or am I being deceptive? And they had to agree. They said, well, you're being deceptive. I said, okay, fine. So you agree with that. The evidence that I'm presenting that I'm a woman is not sufficient, right? Mm-hmm. They said, yes. I said, now, imagine if Jesus was, as your literature says, that his body dissolved in gas, and that's why they didn't recognize him, that's why they thought he was a ghost, all those different things. But there's a problem, because when he came back, he had the nail prints in his hand.
All right, come on.
He still had the nail prints in his feet. And when he saw Thomas, he said, put him in your hand, and he said, my Lord and my God.
Yes, sir.
Now, if Jesus didn't have the same body, and then now he's trying to put on some evidence to try to convince them of something that's not true, then he would be a liar, and he's not telling the truth.
Uh-huh.
And the other one looked at the more experienced one and said, you know what, he has a very good point there. Sir, we got to go. We got to move on. We have other people to witness to.
All right.
Now, my brothers and sisters, I'm going to tell you this. Our whole faith is based on the angel's report.
All right.
Amen. The first gospel given was by an angel, and the last gospel, according to Revelation 14 and 6, will be by an angel, and he's not going to be on the earth. He's going to be flying preaching the gospel because he has wings. Amen. So the point is, and that is, the gospel message is that Jesus had promised that he was going to get up. And when we stand on his promises, many of the things that we worry about, we wouldn't have to worry about. Can you imagine when you stop to think about it, that he did not rebuke them, he did not chastise them, but here they are coming to anoint a body that was not dead any longer. Amen. That he had risen, he said it, so what they were doing was what? In vain. I'm guilty of it, and I will confess it, that sometimes I feel, and I've actually shed a tear over it, that sometimes I don't take God at his word and believe his promise, which would really alleviate a lot of stress and worry in my life if I would just believe him, if I would just be sensitive enough to the Spirit of God and believe him and trust him. I got a call some years ago, I guess probably over a decade ago, that from my niece when I was in Mississippi, that my mother had just had a stroke. As she went on to articulate that your mom was eating some pudding, all of a sudden the pudding fell on her blouse and stained it, and she just stopped moving. She was having a stroke, and so she assured me that she called 911. And I'm all the way in Mississippi, she's in California. There's really nothing I could do but pray. And I talked to the Lord and I asked him, I said, in fact, my prayer was more so on the side of preparing me and being prepared that I would never be able to see my mother like I have seen her in times past.
All right.
And I'm leaning on the side of her not recovering from the stroke. But to my surprise, and I knew that even at that time that God could work it out. I knew that, but I was leaning on the side of she would not return to her original abilities. And I was making plans to go to California doing this and worry and concern and work myself up and everything. And listen, the very next day, I'm not talking about a week, a month. The very next day, she was discharged. No symptoms of the stroke. I mean, nothing was wrong with her. And you know, it hit me so hard. I said, Lord, I said, forgive me. Because I'm preparing myself for the worst, when if I was sensitive to your spirit, you were going to go another way and she would be all right by the next day. Now, my brothers and sisters, here's the problem. They're going to the sepulcher and they're worried about stuff they don't need to worry about because they did not believe what he promised.
Yes, sir.
And isn't that something how it seems that when the angel gives the message or when the preacher gives the word of God, if we don't trust God, how it stings us, because we should be trusting God more than we trust him. I say, yes, we have problems, but oh, thank God for the promise.
Yeah.
Amen. God has promises. Isaiah 41 and 10, he says, fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, whatever betide. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will uphold thee with my righteous right hand.
Yeah.
And even when we have folk that are against us, he says these words. He says, and all those who are against thee shall perish.
Wow.
Amen.
Yeah.
Why should we worry? Why should we fear? You know, we have trouble, we have problems, but if we would just lean and depend on his promises,
amen.
We'll be able to face the promises with new perspective.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Am I right about that?
Amen.
And then lastly, as I close, not only do we look that it begins with a problem, but then the promise sheds light on the problem, which the problem is reduced because of the glorious promise of the Lord.
Right.
Amen. Whatever problem we have, if we look at his promises, whatever we're going through is going to be reduced.
Yeah.
Amen. We'll be able to handle it.
Yeah.
Amen. We'll be able to move on and be able to move on from strength to strength. And then lastly, we got to look at the place. For the angel says he is not here in verse 6. For he is risen. As he said, that's the promise. Come see the place where the Lord lay. Amen. In other words, if you come and examine the place where he was laying, let me just give a detail that Matthew does not give. You have to read the other synoptic gospel or read John to get this one. But when they look at the place where he lay, what they would find is some evidence that there were no grave robbers that came and took his body.
All right.
Because I don't know about you, one time, and I'm going to tell you, this will tell you about how I was when I was younger and young and foolish. Because I used to work for Domino's Pizza when I was 18 and dated my wife at that time. In fact, when I would come to visit her, she would hear me coming before I would get there.
Uh-huh.
Now you say, what in the world does that mean? You know what that means. Young people know what it means. I had them sounds. Amen. I had the boom box. Every time I get a paycheck and I'm spending money, on the boom box. Well, one day, the boom box was stolen. Amen. They broke in and took the boom box and made a mess, left the wires all hanging out. I knew somebody stole it because of how they left it. I hope y'all follow me on this. Now, when you come to the place where Jesus was laying, you don't see it all ravished and everything all out of place. In fact, Jesus got his grave clothes and folded up neatly and laid it there so that as evidence that you know nobody came and stole his body, because when folks steal stuff, they leave it in disarray.
That's right.
Am I right about it? Nobody stole my body because I folded the grave clothes. Amen. Y'all don't hear me. And then when you look at the place where it was laid, it's empty. Amen. I want to make this point because we don't just believe in Jesus because it's an empty tomb. You know, there's been arguments all over the place on what could have happened, all these contingencies, all these controversies. Well, I will say this. The fact that the grave is empty is a hope. Amen. I listen, it's empty, so you know his body wasn't there. But that's not the evidence that proves that he really rose. Because surely somebody can take a body. Amen. And his disciples could have folded it up and make it look like he got out of there, right? But you know, in 1 Corinthians 15, it says over 500 people saw him after the resurrection. Now, that's no longer believing in just an empty tomb that may have other explanations of why it's empty.
All right.
But we believe that we serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living no matter what men may say. Let me tell you something about it. I have seen his hand of mercy, and I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. My brothers and sisters, that empty tomb is also a sign that the other leaders of other religions cannot claim.
Yes, sir. Come on.
Because the leader of Jehovah's Witnesses, which is Charles Taz Russell, I did my homework. He died and he's still in the grave.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The Mormons, Joseph Smith was the leader and founder of the Mormons of Latter-day Saints. He died and he's still in the grave. All the other Confucians and Hare Krishnas and all of those leaders who have died and will die. Nobody is able to come from heaven and point to their place where they laid them that is empty. Only Jesus. And my brothers and sisters, that is our hope. I'm going to close and I say, I heard this story. I like the way Dr. Jerry Young tells this story, because when I was a little boy, I can tell some signs of it, but I can't say what he said, because he did some study I didn't do. But as a little boy in the country, I remember they have those embankments. And you see the holes, like holes are in them. And we would chunk rocks, that's what we call it in the country. Chunk them rocks into them holes, and stuff come running out, and boy, you better get to running, because they had them racer snakes. They had all snakes would come out of there and stuff that'll come and get you. You better get to running. You better run fast, because some of them can get you fast. And when I saw something come out, I was gone, boy. You couldn't beat me running. But listen, Dr. Jerry Young said, what we need today as I close is possum sense.
Right.
I said, possum, I remember seeing those possums. I've seen them dead and I've seen them alive. And the possums would go into the holes of the embankment. But Dr. Jerry Young said this, and I never knew this, but he said the possum has sense enough that when he looks in that hole, in that embankment, in the hole, before he makes it his home, he looks in there and he's looking for footprints.
All right.
And listen, he has enough sense to say that he's looking for footprints, not only the footprints that goes in. And if he only see footprints that go in, he said, I ain't going in that one. But listen, possum says, he said, listen, before he'll make it his home, he looked for the footprints that's coming out. And my brothers and sisters, I don't want to die and go to the grave and believe in somebody that only have footprints that lead in to the grave. We serve a Savior that died on Calvary's cross. Gave up his life. He knew he was going in. He knew he was going in the grave. But on that Sunday morning, footprints coming out of the grave. I'm glad I can die with assurance that I gotta go to the grave. I know the death rate is still one per person. But when I go to the grave, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest man, but only lean on Jesus' name, on Christ. I said on Christ. On Christ. That solid rock I stand. Yeah. All other ground. Yeah. Sinking sand. Yeah. Put your faith and praise God for a faith that trusts the one who went in but had power enough to come out. Amen. That's the message. There may be someone here that prayed to die. I don't know about you, but since I've met the Savior, not afraid to die anymore.
All right.
Used to be afraid of it. But because he says that he has a home for me, because he, as the writer of Hebrews said, he tasted death. He tasted it for us. And I like what Psalm 23, David said, now because of what he did, and he was looking ahead, because of what Jesus did, we only deal with the shadow of death. Amen. Did you get that?
Amen.
I don't have to deal with death or the real thing. Listen, Christ already conquered over death.
Yeah.
He conquered over the devil. He conquered over our sins that is able to cause us to go to hell because we deserve it. We have a Savior who went in and came out. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that he came out of the grave just like he said? And that is the message that we preach. That's the message that every preacher should be preaching. Because that is our hope. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
This time you may not know him and a part of your sins. He loves you. loved you enough to go and deal with what every man in his heart, every woman in their heart fears, and that is death. Amen. We may not talk about it. We may not say anything publicly about it, but a lot of folks are afraid of death. But when you're a child of God, we have too many promises. We have too many precious promises to be afraid of death anymore. Amen. You can come to Jesus. He loves you. He died to save you from your sins. And all you have to do is come to Him, as I did when I was 18 years old. I came to Jesus just as I was. Amen. I gave my life to Him because I heard the gospel by a preacher that's preaching just like I am. You can come to Jesus. He'll save you. He'll forgive you for your sins. Amen. Amen. He's a forgiving God. And then if you don't have a church home, Solid Rock is a wonderful church. Pastor Keys is a wonderful pastor. And somebody said, y'all preach alike. Well, that's a good thing, because I love the way he preached. Amen. I think I love the way he preached better than I love the way I preach. Amen. He's a wonderful pastor and preacher. And if you need a church home, definitely this is a wonderful church home. Amen. And as we close, we do want to close with a word of prayer to just thank God for being a Savior that came out, even though He said He was going in. Lord, we just thank You now. Oh, we bless Your name for the power of the resurrection. Lord, the power of Your resurrection. Your word declares, and the Apostle Paul said, You are the first fruit. And we are those who are benefactors of Your salvific work, of Your redeeming work. Lord, we benefit from what You did. Lord, we couldn't have done it ourselves. We can't go on the grave. We don't have power to come back. But You did. And Lord, You keep Your promises. You keep Your word. And one of the greatest promises in the word of God is the fact that You said You was going to die. And that You were going to come back from the grave. We thank You. You did it. You ascended to the right hand of the Father. And now You're making intercession for us. We thank You because sometimes, Lord, when we pray, we feel weak. We don't know what to say. Sometimes we're lost of words. And yet, we don't have to worry about it. We can pray with confidence. We can come boldly before the throne of grace because You cover whatever we haven't covered. We thank You for that. We again extend, oh God, the intercessory prayer for Pastor Keys and his return. We thank You for his faithful leadership here. We thank You for the members who are carrying on while he's away. We just ask You to put Your loving arms around Solid Rock and move them from strength to strength. Move them from faith to faith. We thank You. We bless Your name. We thank You for the message. May it resound in our ears and our hearts throughout the week, and that we would hold on to that faith that holds us, and that is that You came from the grave. We thank You.
Thank You.
We bless Your name. We give You all the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. God keep you is our prayer.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen.
God has spoken.
So let the church say amen.
Amen. Amen. As we give our benediction, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.